Hello students, welcome back to your economics class. So last class we had learned about organized and unorganized sectors, and we also learned how to give them some job security, how to create more employment opportunities and give them some job security, how to give them some security in their jobs. Now today we are going to learn another way of classifying the economic activities. Economic activities can also be classified on the basis of who owns the assets and who is responsible for the delivery of services. Now, on the basis of ownership, we can classify the economic activities as public sector or private sector. In public sector, the government owns most of the assets and government provides all the services. In private sector, ownership of assets and delivery of service is in the hands of private individuals or companies. Okay, railways or post office, these are all examples of public sector. Whereas companies like Tata Iron and Steel, Reliance, these are all private sector. Activities in the private sector, they are guided by the motive to earn profit. To get such services, we have to pay money to the individuals and companies. The purpose of the public sector is not just to earn profit. Government raises money through taxes and other ways to meet the expenses on the service rendered by it. And so, the main motto of public sector is to provide affordable and accessible services for all. Modern day governments spend on a whole range of activities. Okay? So these are the major differences between public sector and private sector. Public sector, the asset is owned by the government and they provide all the services. And in private sector, the assets are owned by companies and individuals. Another difference is the motto or the reason. In public sector, the main motto is to provide public with affordable and accessible service for everyone. Whereas in the private sector, the main motto is to earn profit. Examples of public sector and examples of private sector. So I want you all to differentiate between public sector and private sector. In your textbooks, just do the markings. And in your textbooks, write down two examples of each. Actually, not two. There are so many options on the screen. Write down four examples of each in your textbook itself. Indian economy is a mixed economy. In a mixed economy, both public and private sectors, they coexist. So in public sector, such enterprises are included which are owned, managed and controlled by the government. Public sector basically includes all government owned enterprises like railways, post office, fire department, etc. Over here, the government has full control over these departments, and the objective of such enterprises is to promote social welfare along with earning profit. In private sector, all such enterprises are included, which are owned by private individuals like Reliance, Tata, Bajaj, etc. The objective of private sector is to earn profit. After the economic policy of 1991, the private sector is growing very rapidly in the Indian economy. Despite of rapid privatization, the role of public investment, that is the importance of public sector, it cannot be undermined. Public sector can provide essential goods to the masses at reasonable prices. The main motive of public sector is public welfare. Role of public investment in some key areas is, will be discussed. So there are several things that are needed by a society as a whole. Which the private sector will not be providing at a reasonable cost. So something needs spending large sums of money which is beyond the capacity of private sector. Collecting money from thousands of people who use these facilities daily is not easy. Even if they do provide these things, they would charge, even if the private sector may be able to provide such things, they will have to charge a high rate for their use. For example, construction of roads, bridges, railway lines, harbors, generating electricity, providing irrigation through them, dams, etc. Governments have to take such heavy spending and ensure that these facilities are available to everyone. These are some activities which the government has to support. The private sector may not continue. The private sector may not continue their production or businesses unless and until the government will encourage them. So the government will have to give good support to the private sector. For example, selling electricity at the cost of generation may push up the cost of production of goods in many industries. So if the person who is selling electricity, he's selling it at its cost price, then his cost of production is going to go up. Many units, especially the small scale units, will have to then shut down. Governments here step in by producing and supplying electricity at the rate which these industries can afford. Government has to bear part of the cost. So if you look at small scale industries, if you look at the production cost and they're going to spend a lot of money on the electricity itself, then they will not run, they will shut down. So if private sector will take is able to provide it at a reasonable rate, good. But there are many activities that require a large sum of money, which private sector cannot afford. And if they can afford, they will provide it at a very high rate. So public sector is very important. Similarly, government in India, they buy wheat and rice from farmers at a fair price. This they store in the godowns and then they sell at a lower price to consumers through ration shops. Okay, the government will again bear some cost for this. But in this way, the government is supporting both the farmer and the consumer. There are large number of activities which are primarily responsible of the government. The government must spend on these, providing health and education facilities for all. We have discussed some of these issues in the first chapter when we did. Okay, like running proper schools, providing quality education, particularly elementary education is the duty of the government. India's size of illiterate population is one of the largest in the world, and that means to create good human capital, we have to provide good education to these illiterate population so that they do not become a liability, but they become an asset to the country. Similarly, we also know that half of India's children are malnourished. That means we also should provide good health facilities. And a quarter of them are always critically ill. Have you read about the infant mortality rate? The infant mortality rate of Odisha is 53, Madhya Pradesh is 56, and it is higher than some of the poorest regions in the world. So even the poorest region in the world has lower mortality rate than Odisha and Madhya Pradesh today. Government also needs to pay attention to aspects of human development, such as availability of safe drinking water, housing facilities for the poor, and food and nutrition. It is also the duty of government to take care of the poorest and the most ignored regions of the country through increased spending. So basically, although we know public sector, in fact, you all must be knowing more about the public sector than the private sector. But role of public investment or the public sector is very, very important. Role of public sector in education, because education implies the process of teaching, training, and learning, especially in schools or colleges. And this is to improve our knowledge and develop our skills. India's size of literate population is the largest in the world, and so the education sector needs government intervention, particularly for providing elementary education. Private schools are generally located in the urban areas and they charge more fees. One truth that you must now all know, that in urban areas like ours, we have private schools, and these schools are charging a lot of fees. The poor people cannot afford these fees, okay? And so the government intervention is required for setting up schools, particularly in the rural areas, so that the children of the poor family also get an opportunity to educate themselves. Government will also play a significant role. It should play a significant role in providing higher and professional education. This I actually know personally, because I had a cousin of mine whose house helped. He has three daughters, and he told me that he told my cousin that his daughter was learning medicine. She was learning to become a nurse. So we asked him how. So he said there is a special school which has been put up close to his village, where lots of children, all especially the girls, are going, and they are getting educated specially for the field of becoming nurses. Similarly, his other daughter was going to a local workshop to learn stitching and embroidery. So all these are, honoring our human capital formation. They are all making the youth of the country more independent, more literate, and at the and we are looking forward to a better development of the country. Yes? So this is another sector. If you divide the sectors into private and public, the importance of both sectors is very important to understand. So government has set up various universities, colleges, and professional institutions to help the poor achieve education and develop the correct skills. Now, what is the role of government in investment in health facilities? So health is basically a state of complete physical, mental, and social well-being. It does not simply mean absence of diseases. Okay, today when we are all home-ridden, somewhere down the line, we are not socially being able to connect with each other, which is somewhere down the line giving us a little bit of mental, it is not keeping us mentally very, very, very fit. So today, if we can go out for a little walk, or if you can meet your friends on through a video call, you feel very happy, and these are helping you all stay mentally fit. Again, if you remember the DR thing that we had done when Prime Minister had told us, or we banged those plates and made sound. These were all for the mental well-being. Okay, again, this was a government initiative towards the mental well-being when they knew that there's a lockdown coming in and this is not normal for us. This is not every day for us to stay at home. So health is a state of being physically, mentally, and socially completely fit. It does not simply mean absence of diseases. It means a sound physical and mental state of an individual. So improvement in the health of population is an important element of human resource development. So today, when everything is under lockdown, and I have already read reports where so many public properties, many private properties have also been taken over by the government, and they have been converted to isolation centers, or they've been converted to treatment centers. You know, there is a hospital that has been taken over, which is a complete COVID hospital now. So all these things, this is where the this is government investment in the health of the people. Okay, so government has taken significant steps to provide good health facilities in the country. The role of public investment in providing health facilities can be highlighted by the by some observations. Number one, that the government has set up many hospitals and dispensaries, community health centers, primary health care centers, etc. In 1951, there were only 725 primary health care centers in the country. Today, this number has increased to 22,842 in the year 2005. Government hospitals and medical facilities are given at a very nominal price at the government hospitals. These government hospitals have been set up in both rural areas as well as urban areas. The government hospitals, they are equipped with modern health equipment, and good health facilities are within the reach of poor people. Okay, there is vaccination against dangerous diseases like malaria, TB, smallpox. Okay, government hospitals are free of cost. A government has also launched a special campaign for eradicating certain diseases like polio. A government operates the FCI, that is Food Corporation of India, which takes into its which takes over the duty of distribution of food amongst the people of India. The primary responsibility of government also includes providing health and education facilities for all. Now, government has also set up many medical colleges, medical research centers like PGIMR, so as to promote health, to promote research in medicines. Okay. Besides all this, government also plays a major role in the service sector generation of employment. In India, 61% of working population is engaged in the primary sector, and 22% of working population is engaged in the service sector. So in the secondary sector, only 17% of working population is engaged. Although service sector and secondary sector have been able to contribute a large percentage to GDP, yet these two sectors have not been able to generate sufficient employment. This we have already discussed at the beginning of the chapter. In the absence of employment opportunities in secondary and tertiary sectors, people are forced to remain busy and earn livelihood in the primary sector, because tertiary and secondary sector is not giving enough employment opportunities. So people are forced to take up any sort of employment in the primary sector. In primary sector, more than required for workforce is engaged. We've already seen this, that even if we remove a few people from the farm, still the productivity remains the same, and so it gives rise to disguised employment. The growth of service sector in India is not on the pattern of developed nations with regard to employment generation. In developed nations, service sector makes significant contribution in both GDP and employment. In India, 61% of working population is engaged in primary sector, and its contribution to GDP is only 23%. It means that people are not getting gainful employment in the primary sector. Okay. We've already spoken about all this, so we will not spend a lot of time over it now. Okay, so with this, we've ended the chapter today. What I want you all to do is basically, actually just let me do a little summary before we finish the chapter. So in this chapter, we looked at the ways of classifying economic activities into meaningful groups on the basis of the ownership, on the basis of the work that they do. Okay, and we also did primary, secondary and tertiary sectors. We saw the interdependence of sectors. We saw the comparison of the sectors, that we saw that the data for India for the last 30 years shows that while goods and services produced in the tertiary sector contribute most to the GDP, the employment still remains mostly in the primary sector. We also saw that all can be done for what all can we do for increasing the employment opportunities in the country. Then we saw how to classify economic activities by organized and unorganized sector. Okay, then we saw how most people are working in unorganized sector and how can we protect them, how can we give them job security. We also looked at difference between private and public activities, and why finally we ended the chapter on why public activities are very important. Okay, so with this we have completed the chapter. I have three questions for you all to do in your notebook. They are just one line. Actually, they're very, very easy. I want you all to actually don't do it in your notebooks. Just write down the answers in the comments of this video, because there are only three questions and all of them are multiple choice and the first one is odd one out. And why? So MTNL, Indian Railways, Air India, Sahara Airline and All India Radio. One of it is odd one out. I want you all to pick it and write it and comment it on this video. Next, which one of the following is a private sector industry? Rail, disco, oil and sail. And see, find out their full forms for yourself. This is very important. Lastly, the sectors are classified into public and private sectors on the basis of what? These three answers, I want to see the answers in the comment section of this video. With this, I end today's class. We have ended this chapter today. Go revise the chapter. If you don't understand anything, feel free to contact me. Also, all the work that I give you, drawing, sticking, writing, make sure you give me your feedback. Click a picture and send it to me with your name, standard roll number, so that I know who you are. Feedback is very important. That's the only way we both can connect with each other. So please send me your feedback. Stay home, stay safe, take care, and keep learning. Thank you.